Hi, this is Dr. A with a clinical chemistry review video on pregnancy and prenatal testing, and we're going to look at diseases associated with the mother in pregnancy. So the first complication we're going to discuss is preeclampsia. So preeclampsia is evidenced by high blood pressure, usually above 160 over 110, and proteinuria more than 3+ on two random specimens. And this is protein in the urine, so there would be two random urine specimens. And edema after the 20th week. So edema is swelling, especially in the legs and feet. It can be severe, have caused all kinds of problems to the mom. It tends to occur in the second and third trimester. It occurs in 5% of pregnancies, and it is not completely understood. The risk factors for preeclampsia is being older than 40 years old, of the black race, having a family history of preeclampsia, having chronic renal disease, chronic hypertension, diabetes, being pregnant with twins, or having a high BMI, meaning being overweight or obese. The only treatment for preeclampsia is the delivery of the baby, and then of course you are concerned with preterm delivery of a baby. If the baby is to be delivered before 37 weeks, then the fetal lung maturity is a concern because the baby's lungs are not mature enough. And what we would do for that is give the mom corticosteroids to try to mature up the lungs of the baby so that the baby doesn't go into respiratory distress when the baby's born. So some of the lab tests that we do to screen for preeclampsia is the urine protein. So that's a quick dipstick that's done at the physician's office at the OBGYN during prenatal care, but we can also do CBC, AST, and ALT, which are liver enzymes, serum uric acid, and creatinine, and we would be concerned if the AST, ALT, serum uric acid, creatinine are elevated, and the urine protein is elevated. And so that's preeclampsia, and then this could potentially go full on into eclampsia, which is a life-threatening complication of preeclampsia, but it is rare in the United States. In eclampsia, the mom will develop grand mal seizures and could fall into a coma. There may be intracranial hemorrhage, so brain bleeds. It is associated with teen mothers and mothers that are over 35 years old, but it is definitely associated with those who lack prenatal care or access to healthcare services. So you can see this more in third world countries. Now, HELLP syndrome is a life-threatening manifestation of preeclampsia. HELLP syndrome, the HELLP stands for hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelet count. And so in the CBC, that's the one thing you're looking for is the low platelet count. The mom can develop thrombocytopenia, so low platelets, and DIC, which is disseminated intravascular coagulation, which is where you get small, tiny blood clots that form all over the body. And so it's a clotting problem. But then what happens is those little tiny clots will use up all the clotting factors and can then develop into a bleeding problem. So this can be life-threatening. It occurs usually between the 27th and 36th week, and it could occur also after delivery. The symptoms of HELLP syndrome are right upper quadrant pain, which indicate liver involvement, malaise, so you just don't feel good, nausea and vomiting, headache, and jaundice. So jaundice is another liver-related symptom. And then the lab results would be high LDH, high AST, high ALT, and then of course the low platelet count. And hemolysis would show then also a decreasing hemoglobin, hematocrit, and red cell count also. Another complication is hyperemesis gravidarum, and this is basically really bad morning sickness. So 70% of pregnancies are complicated with this hyperemesis gravidarum, which is severe morning sickness. So it's a severe form of nausea and vomiting in which the mom will suffer weight loss and ketosis because she can't hold any food or water down. It can lead to an imbalance in the acid base. So with the ketosis, could lead to a metabolic acidosis, and there's an imbalance in electrolytes from the dehydration. There'll be nutritional deficits also. The symptoms are nausea and vomiting, fatigue, dizziness, depression, and anxiety. And the lab tests that can be done are the UA, CBC, BMP, liver function tests, hepatitis, amylase, lipase, TSH, urine cultures, and ketones. So the ketones would be expected to be elevated because mom might be in ketosis because she can't keep any food down. Some of these other tests are done more to rule out other possible complications and other problems with pregnancy. So other causes, if you will, of nausea and vomiting. Another complication is ectopic pregnancy. And this is when a fertilized egg implants outside of the uterus. The trophoblastic cells will prematurely attach to the lining of the fallopian tube instead of attaching to the uterine endometrium. The symptoms are going to be lower abdominal pain, vaginal bleeding, and the cessation of menses. The causes of ectopic pregnancies are damaged fallopian tubes, probably from chronic pelvic inflammatory disease, so chronic female problems with infections and sexually transmitted diseases. The diagnostic test is going to be serial quantitative levels of HCG to confirm an ectopic pregnancy and to monitor the removal of the fertilized egg from the fallopian tube. And we got to maintain, you've got to establish that there's a pregnancy and then where it is. So I imagine some ultrasound might be involved in that too, to figure out what's going on. But then ultimately, the solution is to remove that fertilized egg from the fallopian tube. Next is gestational diabetes. And so this can be a complication that shows up in the second or third trimester. We usually screen for gestational diabetes between the 24th and 28th week of gestation using the glucose tolerance test. So the screening glucose tolerance test is just a 1 hour one. So mom comes in usually fasting, give her a 50 gram dose of glucose. She drinks it. An hour later, we draw the glucose level, and we want to see a glucose level less than 140 milligrams per DL at the 1 hour screening. If it's less than 140, it's all good. If it's above 140, then we're concerned about gestational diabetes. They can repeat the glucose tolerance test to the full glucose tolerance test. And that one, it would be a 3 hour glucose tolerance test where the mom again would come in fasting, give her a dose of glucose, and then we check the glucose at 1 hour, 2 hour, and 3 hour, and to see if she has gestational diabetes. And then we're looking for elevations in any of those. The problem is gestational diabetes can lead to really large babies, which can be complicated to deliver. And so we definitely want to manage that. Another complication is if mom develops gestational diabetes, she could also develop type 2 diabetes later on in life. So that wraps up our complications for the mom, and I appreciate your attention.